All right, so let's talk a little bit about fake news. I put this picture of sort of something that represents white noise. If half of our news is fake and half of it's real, it makes it hard to discern truth and non-truth. And the sad part is the huge investment that it's going to take for everyone to decipher what's real. So it's a real cost to society. So we talk about costs in the medical field all the time, the cost of creating vaccinations to combat things like the flu. We should also talk about the costs of trying to decipher the truth in a world where we're being completely infiltrated by false news and misinformation. As Thomas Jefferson said in a letter to Charles Yates back in the 1800s, if a nation expects to be ignorant and free in a state of civilization, it expects what never was and never will be. The people cannot be safe without information. And that's what we want to be able to do as a society, is sort of clean that up. But it can't come from one organization or from just a government. It has to come from the people.
This is why I don't think it's hyperbole to say that fake news is really an attack on democracy. Because we really do need, in a representative democracy, in a liberal democracy, to know what's going on. And if we can't tell what's true from what's false, and we end up saying, well, you know, damn it, I just don't know, then we can't really make good decisions collectively about how we want to run our country.
I completely agree. The sad part is that many of our leaders, and this, again, this comes from Republican side, Democratic side, from all sides of the political aisle, but when a lot of our leaders are promulgating news that I think they absolutely know is false, I mean, look at this particular tweet. Breaking news bombshell. NYPD blows whistle on new Hillary emails. Money laundering, sex, crimes with children, child exploitation, pay to play, perjury. General Flynn, you decide. And rewrites it, gets this many tweets and this many likes. One of the main leaders, at least previous leaders, of our government, sharing this kind of information. Now, there are these sort of conspiracy theories that have been around a long time. There was a recent survey by Alcott and Jensqua in a recent NBR paper where they looked at the current views on many of these conspiracy theories. So the 1975, now that doesn't mean that these aren't true, but at least the prevailing opinion, at least among scholars, is that they're sort of in the category of conspiracy. If you look at, for example, in 1975, the assassination of Martin Luther King was the act of part of a larger conspiracy. 60% of Americans believe that's true. There are more than 10% that still believe that Barack Obama was born in another country, even after the recent admittance over the last 6 months or so, even from those that were pushing that particular opinion. The U.S. government knew the 9/11 attacks were coming, but consciously let them proceed. A quarter of Americans believe that. Bush administration purposely misled the public about evidence that Iraq had banned weapons. More than 30% believe that. The President Roosevelt knew Japanese plans to bomb Pearl Harbor, but did nothing. So even without the fake news, you still will have parts of society that will believe these things. And when news comes across that confirms their opinion, it only sort of further facilitates these sorts of things. So here's some news from that same article. First of all, it doesn't matter if you're a Democrat or Republican. You're about 15% more likely to believe these ideological aligned headlines when they again confirm your biases. So we've talked a lot about that in the quarter, the sort of role of confirmation bias in trying to discern these sorts of things. Of the top fake stories that were spread, this was based on this article. So one of these authors is from NYU and one from Stanford. They've done this extensive study and they looked at the top stories shared, and 115 of them were pro-Trump fake stories that were shared on Facebook up to 30 million times. There were 41 pro-Clinton fake stories that were shared nearly 8 million times. And they have this calculation, you just sort of have to believe it or read the paper and see. I'm still sort of trying to think through what the calculation is, how they do it, but let's just buy their number for right now. These shares, they calculate, resulted in 760 million actual reads. That means that if there was 300 million people in the United States on average, these articles are being, there's three of these kinds of articles are being read by all Americans. Now, of course, you could be in that category that's read none of these, but there are those that have read a lot of them then to get that kind of number. Now, it's so bad right now that even they're finding, there's lots and lots of papers are now showing that people even believe satire. So this is from The Onion. This was one of the most shared one that was put up there, that Taylor Swift now dating Senator Joseph McCarthy. Now, you can read the sort of, you guys have read it already, what's going on here. Your songs carry no more weight. Fourth guy in less than 6 months. That's a record. I really hope you realize this is fake. This dude died 50 years ago. Okay, thank God, because I was going to seriously throw out the CDs in the bin. Lol. Okay, so now this is, you know, a microcosm. And some of these things, you know, you don't know if people really believe it or not. But it's clear that if that these satires even are being believed by portions of the public. Here's this story, again, about the FBI suspected in Hillary email links found. Again, I put Snopes up here. I'll keep putting these Snopes or factcheck.org because you should start using this website more often. And anything we can do to support these kinds of organizations that are doing fact-checking, I think are doing a real service to our society. But just so you know, this is not just a Trump thing or a Hillary thing. Snopes also is finding things that are absolutely false about Trump's administration. So there was a lot of sort of attention to this news story that Trump removed the Martin Luther King bust. It was plain not true, but this passed around and received more attention than it should have. So there's lots of different definitions, but since we're going to talk about fake news today, let's talk a little bit about at least some of the definitions that are given. Since I've referenced this one paper several times, and I'll reference it a couple more times in the talk, let's see sort of how they think about it. They've been doing research on this. News articles that are intentionally and verifiably false and could mislead readers. That's how they view fake news. News on the internet, this is something that New York Times and different news sources and editors have put together some definitions too. So news on the internet that is fictitious, articles deliberately fabricated to deceive readers, generally with the goal of profiting through clickbait. I like that one. That sort of fits with what I've been seeing in looking at all these fake news stories. And fake news, according at least to the general definition that it's been accepted, at least in the Wikipedia community, is a type of yellow journalism. We'll talk a little bit about that. That consists of deliberate misinformation or hoaxes spread via the traditional print, broadcasting news media, or via internet-based social media. Excuse me.
Right, so the internet site thinks that it's spread by print, and the print site thinks it's spread by internet. That's cute.
yeah, it's the other person's, it's the other media's fault. Here's the thing that, from my standpoint as a researcher in the technology area, that is a little bit, it's a little disturbing, but it's not to be unexpected, given how complicated it is to build a search engine and to build these kinds of tools to figure out what people want. But the fake news is also fooling the smartest of our search engines. So if you put this particular vote, I'll give credit to Dan Abrams who found this. This was recently, it was not long after the election. If you put into Google final vote count 2016, the first hit that would have come up was final election count numbers. Trump won both popular and electoral colleges. That was all based, the search engine, after some forensics by Dan and others, found that it went back to this individual, Michael Coxing A8, whatever his little name is on Twitter. He had these particular numbers. Some sort of random dude that had some numbers, put it up. It sort of swept through a lot of news media and landed on the front page of a search if you were to search and you were trying to figure out what the final counts were. This kind of thing is extra scary if you come up with any crazy idea. That's the thing about fake news. It doesn't cost much to come up with a crazy idea. It costs a lot to build the vaccination to that crazy idea. But Google and Bing and a lot of the major search engines, they only know what's out there on the web. So if you come up with a crazy idea and the rest of the world hasn't had time to come up with the antidote to that, what's Google going to find? They're going to find and then deliver to you the result that the result that they had found on the air. So if you search, is Obama planning a coup? If you're asking, is Obama planning a coup? This is the first thing that comes up before it was corrected, by the way. Again, this was done by an individual, Paul, on his website. He had found that according to details exposed in Western culture for journalism, exclusive video, not only could Obama be in bed with communist Chinese, but Obama may be, in fact, be planning a communist coup d'etat at the end of the term in 2016. So while Carl talks about this one, I'm just going to show you a quick little video.
And it's not just politics, right? Here's another example of how this can happen very easily. This is one I found. There's this crazy idea that that vaccines are causing shaken baby syndrome rather than shaking babies. So there are a bunch of articles in the sort of naturopathic community that say this. It's such a fringe idea that, unlike the notion that there's a vaccine autism leak, there is no scientific research about this because it makes absolutely no sense. It's really loony. So if you go and you ask Google, do vaccinations cause shaken baby syndrome? The only things that it can possibly find that combine these, right, are these articles in Age of Autism, this National Vaccine Information Center, which is I'd describe as a National Vaccine Disinformation Center, Vax Truth, same kind of thing. So anyway, this is a big problem for search engines that we're grappling with now is, what do you do when people make up things that are so out there that no one's even rebutting them yet? How do you not just deliver the nonsense when queried about it?
Okay, so a lot of people are starting to get these personal assistants at home. And if you ask this personal assistant, this is the Google personal assistant, it's not Alexa, this is the Google's, that same question.
Is Obama planning a coup?
According to secrets of the Fed. According to details exposed in Western Center for Journalism's exclusive video, not only could Obama be in bed with the communist Chinese, but Obama may in fact be planning a communist coup d'etat at the end of his term in 2016.
QD.
They still need to. They still need to work out. Yeah. I have a hard time too.
Fair enough. It's French-ish.
Yeah. So some other kind of facts about, or sort of some issues around fake news are their places of origin. And what's the deal with Veles, Macedonia? It turns out that a lot of the fake news, I mean, there's lots more, it's not just in this place, but there's a preponderance of fake news coming out of this small little town in this small country. In fact, the town is around 55,000 people, but it turns out that a lot of fake news is coming out of there. Now, why would it want to come? I mean, why, first of all, are these places, whether it's Macedonia or in the United States, why would you spend time creating fake news?
So my conspiracy theory notion has got to be a KGB outpost, right, Jevin?
Yeah, of course. Do you have an article to cite
sure
around this?
I'm sure I can
find one.
It's not.
Yeah, exactly. So why? Why are we seeing so much now effort and production? Again, we don't know the exact numbers. It's a hard thing to measure. But let's just say it's even 25% of the content that's spreading around our digital environments is fake news. Why are we seeing it? What's one of the main reasons? Exactly. There's money to be made. A lot of money. There are different calculations for this. We'd have to reference. But let's say for every million hits you get to a crazy story, you might make $5,000. And there are people that are on a regular basis getting 80 million hits to their article or to the crazy ideas they're coming up with. And there's justifications from these producers saying, oh, it's just satire. It's like, what's the difference between this fake news and nonfiction?
Fiction.
Big difference between fiction, for sure. I certainly would claim there is a big difference. But it's not just the money that can be made from it. There's something other interesting about this kind of activity. It's like it's different than other commodities. It's cheap to make. Because there's a lot of money to be made in lots of industries. There's a lot of money to be made in cars and building cell phones and running a corporate-sized restaurants. But this is cheap and easy to do. There's a lot of money to make. So please don't go do this. Help do the cleaning up. But that's one of the big reasons. This is also international. It's not, of course, I don't think I need to convince you that this is not something that's unique to the United States. This was out of the Philippines. This sort of stuff was spread around a lot. Some NASA astronaut apparently considers Duarte as the best president in the entire solar system. So I wonder if that helped him. Now, here's one thing that's a little bit interesting about fake news. Right now, there are states, this one's from the state of California, are trying to pass legislation to make fake news against the law. And as much as I really think that fake news is hurting us as a society, I'm not so sure this is a good idea. I think it's a slippery slope. Our First Amendment rights are really at risk. Carl, you may have some opinions about this too. I think we've had some discussions. But this one, I'm not so sure is a good idea. But you're going to start seeing these kinds of laws being at least proposed in different states. This is another quote that sort of struck us as something that's important. If you have a society where people can't agree on basic facts, how do we have a functioning democracy? And that's what this fake news is doing. It's really sort of muddling our agreement on facts.
And I just want to point out, I think it's even worse than can't agree on facts. There's this notion of tribal epistemology, which is that we can't, not only can we not agree on what the facts are, we can't even agree on what the procedures might be that we would plausibly use to determine the facts. Right? So there's just a totally different notion of how you would arrive at evidence, of what evidence actually is, what it consists of, depending on your tribal allegiance. In this case, you are with the American left or the American right. This is a position we haven't been at before. We've been, you know, for decades in places where there are disagreements about the facts, there are disagreements about what will be the consequences of reducing income tax for businesses or something like that. But now we're getting to a point where we can't even agree on how you might go about settling questions of facthood. And that is almost a point of no return. I find it really scary.